We are utterly fascinated by tidally locked planets. Ever since the first tidally locked planet around other stars were discovered, we were wondering how would life be on such a planet? How would it be to live on the eternal day side? And how would it be on the eternal night side? The imagination can run wild here. And believe it or not, but more and more research is being conducted in order to estimate how the climate conditions on such planets are.
In the first part of this two-part series, we're going to explore how the conditions on such tidally locked planets might be. And in the second part, we're going to explore how life would look on such a planet. And more interestingly, how would an advanced, intelligent civilization on such a planet look and behave? There's a lot of speculation in this video, so please only proceed if you're as completely fascinated by this type of planet as we are. So then I say, let's start! The Earth. A neat planet, circling a type G2V spectral class yellow dwarf star in the Orion arm of a barred spiral galaxy. The Earth rotates once every 24 hours, and so do the other planets in this solar system. However, what if we told you that this is actually not the norm? In fact, G-type stars such as the Sun only make up 7.6% of the total stellar population. There is a type of star that is much more prevalent, namely the M-type red dwarf, which makes up a staggering 76.45% of the total stellar population. That's right, 3/4 of all stars in the galaxy are red dwarfs. And this ratio is very similar in other galaxies like the Milky Way. M-type red dwarfs are much smaller, less massive, and cooler than the Sun. The largest ones are 60% as massive as the Sun, have 62% the radius, 7.2% the luminosity, and a surface temperature of 3800 Kelvin, while the smallest ones have only 7.5% the mass of the Sun, 8% the radius, 0.015% the luminosity, and a surface temperature of only 2300 Kelvin. So there is quite a bandwidth there. Many M-type red dwarfs are flare stars that emit giant flares of highly energetic particles. Almost all of these stars are thought to have planets orbiting them. Now, the fascinating thing about these planets is that since they orbit the parent star much closer than the Earth orbits the Sun, actually even a lot closer than Mercury orbits the Sun, a consequence is that these planets are tidally locked. The currently most famous such system is the TRAPPIST-1 system.
The planet system around this small red dwarf star was discovered in 2015 with the Transiting Planet and Planetesimal Small Telescope, short TRAPPIST, hence the name. The central star is an M8V type red dwarf star with a mass of almost 9% the mass of the Sun, a radius of 11.9% the Sun's radius, and a surface temperature of 2566 Kelvin. There are several things especially fascinating about this system. First, 7 planets were discovered to orbit TRAPPIST-1. Yes, 7! And more, all planets are rocky planets with sizes similar to that of Earth. The whole system is so small that it's even dwarfed by the orbit of Mercury around the Sun. The planets are called TRAPPIST-1b to h in alphabetical order. Especially interesting are planets TRAPPIST-1d and e, both of which could have the necessary conditions to allow liquid water on the surface. Here is an artist's impression of how the view from TRAPPIST-1d might look like. Since this system is so ridiculously small, you would see the central star a bit more than 4 times as large in the sky compared to the Sun from Earth. Even more insane, the other planets would be clearly visible as big balls in the sky with the unaided eye, the nearest ones appearing as large as the Moon does from Earth when they are nearest.
So let's imagine now that you are on TRAPPIST-1d, the one from this artist's impression here. The central red dwarf star would stand unchanging in the sky. You would have eternal day on the side of the planet facing the star and eternal night on the side of the planet facing away from the star. Since you would not have a day-night cycle as on Earth, you would lose all the feeling of time. Only the position of the other planets in the sky would reveal that things are changing. But you would find no day or night cycle, nor would you find any seasons. Thus, the passage of time on such tidally locked planets is really quite different than on Earth. It would be much more subtle, and thus also, this will have very strong implications for how an alien society would develop and think that would have developed on such a fascinating world. And please subscribe to our channel, because as you can see, we're not just the standard Starship this, Starship that channel, but we also talk about many other different topics. But we need your support in order to do that. So thank you very much in advance.
Tidally locked planets around red dwarf stars are sometimes also called eyeball planets or eyeball Earths, because they would have a hot zone near to the center point facing the central star, a temperate region along the terminator line, and then ice towards the eternal darkness. This layered structure thus giving the impression of a giant eyeball. Many studies are being conducted by researchers around the globe in order to shed some light on how the conditions on such planets might be. For example, in the paper, Transition from Eyeball to Snowball Driven by Sea Ice Drift on Tidally Locked Terrestrial Planets by Young and others, published in 2019 in Nature Astronomy, the researchers ran some simulations for a large parameter set that can influence the climate on eyeball planets. They take into account the amount of starlight which the planets receive. For example, TRAPPIST-1e receives only 2/3 of the light intensity as Earth does from the Sun, so around 900 watts per square meter. Then they take into account the density of the atmosphere, different atmosphere compositions, and of course, also the amount of greenhouse gases present in the atmosphere, such as CH4 and CO2. Last but not least, also how land masses and sea ice drift would affect the climate. These guys were really quite thorough.
They come to the conclusion that many of these planets would be frozen worlds, or mostly frozen worlds, with only the sun-facing point being ice-free. Of course, for planets nearer to their parent star and with higher concentrations of CO2 in the atmosphere, they find that these worlds could be in fact completely ice-free on the day side. In another paper, published in July 2016, in Progress in Earth and Planetary Science, titled The Middle Atmospheric Circulation of a Tidally Locked Earth-like Planet and the Role of the Sea Surface Temperature, by Prodrow and others, the researchers performed some simulations employing a 3D chemistry-based climate model. They simulated how the climate on Earth would behave if Earth was a tidally locked planet, getting the same 1,368 watts per square meters of stellar flux from the Sun as we do now, but for the case that Earth is tidally locked. Surprisingly, they found that the temperature variation from day to night side is not as drastic as some would think. In fact, the coldest point at the antistellar spot on the night side, which is the spot furthest away from the star, would be 250 Kelvin. This is 23 degrees Celsius below zero. And it would measure 300 Kelvin at the substellar spot, the region nearest to the star. This is plus 27 degrees Celsius, which means that a thick enough atmosphere will allow for sufficient heat transport in order to avoid extremely cold temperatures on the night side, which would have the atmosphere freeze out. Therefore, tidally locked planets with a sufficiently dense atmosphere would not lose their entire atmosphere due to outfreezing, as had been initially thought. Interestingly, eyeball planets would be very windy. And of course, you would have a constant, never-ending wind, because as we said, there are no seasons, nor day and night cycles, so the conditions would be unchanging. And of course, some people have also performed some simulations here, such as Yong-Yun Hu and Yun Yang in 2013.
Depending on how fast the planet rotates around the central star, we can also have Coriolis forces. Believe it or not, despite the planet being tidally locked, these forces will of course strongly depend on how fast the planet circles the parent star. The faster, the higher the Coriolis forces, which will also influence the wind patterns. The substellar point receives the highest stellar flux, therefore it's heated up the most. Warm air then rises high up into the atmosphere and will then be transported to the antistellar point on the dark side, where it falls down to the surface again. Of course, air keeps coming continuously, so it is being pressed sideways, thus flowing back from the dark side to the dayside over the terminator, all the way back to the substellar point. Similar to Hadley convection on Earth, which is the reason why we have rainforests at the equator and deserts at the turning circles of the sun at 23.5 degrees northern and southern latitude.
Okay, so now that we understand the conditions on such an eyeball planet a bit better, let's imagine a concrete example. Let's imagine a tidally locked planet circling a not-so-active M-type dwarf star that doesn't produce too many intense showers of radiation, which will probably be a prerequisite for life to form. Of course, life might be more resilient than we think, but it makes sense to assume that chances are a lot better in star systems where the M-type star is not a very active flare star. Plus, let's imagine that the planet gets enough tidal heating from the star by better dissipating the heat in the planet's mantle, thereby cooling the core and allowing for the formation of a magnetic field. Of course, there are research papers that found that tidally locked planets can have magnetic fields. Let's say that the planet has continents and oceans with a makeup similar as Earth. It might even have one or more moons which create tidal forces. Let's say that there is a large landmass at the substellar point. Of course, we also assume that CO2 levels and stellar flux are sufficiently high as to not have the planet freeze.
We would then find giant rainforests at the substellar point, very similar to Earth, where the rainforests are located on a belt around the equator. But on an eyeball planet, the rainforests would be concentrated at and around the substellar point. The plants would not be green here. No, they would be pitch black, because the light they receive from their red dwarf parent star is so dim, they would need to absorb all of the light spectrum, thus black would be most efficient. Around a patch of black rainforests, we would have a ring of deserts. This is also similar to how deserts are located on Earth, exactly at the turning point of the sun. Since the ring on this tidally locked planet would have precipitated already above the rainforests, the air that is being pushed to the site would be extremely dry, leading to the deserts. Now we are nearing the temperate zone. The more we near the terminator, that is the region where the dayside goes over into the nightside, the more we get a temperature-wise moderate region. But we would have giant rivers here and strong perpetual winds. The winds that rush back from the dark side are never-ending, constant and strong. Huge rivers from the meltwater of the ice sheets and snow-covered landscapes of the dark side would flow across this zone back towards the warmer regions of the substellar point. And in this region, we would also have a perpetual, never-ending sunset, or sunrise. This certainly makes for quite some spectacular views. And how life would look like and behave on such an eyeball planet, we shall explore in part 2 of this small video series, which we are going to release very soon.
And a special thanks to our viewer Vatsyayana, who came up with a lot of nice ideas for this episode. So thank you a lot, Vats, for helping us.
And we also want to thank everyone who watches this channel either on YouTube or on Odyssey. And special thanks to all the people who ever donated to us via PayPal or Bitcoin.
Your generousness is highly appreciated. So then, thanks for watching the JS Space Report, and I would say, on to the future.